Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our 2017 annual AAF donor meeting. Thank you all so much for coming out this morning. I know a lot of you all will be going straight to the spring game at 1 o'clock, but we do appreciate you all coming out this morning to meet with us. A couple of things. We do have Joe Parker here. Joe Parker is one of our past presidents for the Aggie Athletic Foundation, so he will be here representing the board. Of course, I'm Shamika, and I am the interim athletics director for development and the interim executive director of the Aggie Athletic Foundation. And so let's go ahead and get things started with some housekeeping items. Of course, we would like you all to turn off your phones or put it on vibrate, please. We are live streaming this, so we don't want the outside noise if we can at all help it. And then those that are online right now that are tuned in, you do have a section on YouTube where you can add a question to the comment area. We will try our best to get to those questions. However, if we do not get to your questions during this session, we will follow up with you within the next couple of days with whatever type of questions that you may have. We also will be taking questions from the audience. However, we can't ask questions, and we don't have a wireless mic, so we will ask you to come up to the front to ask your questions so that you can be seen online as well. So without further ado, I'm going to bring up Joe Parker. He's going to give up a few comments, and then we'll get started with the meeting.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can I get an Aggie pride?
Aggie pride!
Oh, come on, one more time. Aggie pride! Thank you, thank you. I'm Joe Parker. I'm a member of the board of directors of the Aggie Athletic Foundation. And on behalf of our board chair, Ponce Titwell, and my fellow board members, I welcome you to the Aggie Athletic Foundation annual board meeting. Ponce has a family obligation and will not be with us today. As you know, the mission of the Aggie Athletic Foundation is to support the athletics department here at A&T. That commitment includes financial support for athletic scholarships, equipment, and facilities. And because of you, we must say that we are meeting our mission goals. You, our donors, are the lifeline to the AAF. Without your support, we would not be here today. So for that, I say thank you. The AAF continues to grow both in the number of donors as well as revenue. We'll hear more about this later during our presentation. And also we'll hear about some of our accomplishments, future initiatives, and events. At this time, I would like to recognize board members that might be present today. Would you please stand if you're a board member? We have three: Ken Siegman to my right, Eugene Fields to my left, and Stephen Harrington further to my left. Thank you all for being here. I would also like to recognize our past chairperson, Teresa Davis. Would you stand, please? Teresa was the leader of this organization for almost 4 years as our chair and a member of the board for about 5.5 years. And during that time, she did an outstanding job. Thank you so much. I would also like to recognize two other individuals. One that spoke a minute ago, and that is Shamika Platform, our interim executive director, and Angelica Smith, our administrative assistant. These two individuals manage the day-to-day operations of our organization, and they do an outstanding job, so thank you so much. Again, thank you for coming, and thank you for your support. Shamika.
All right, so we'll kick things off by going over our agenda first. Of course, I will go first with AAF operations update and governance updates. Then we'll have Kiana Taylor, which is our ticket office manager. She'll give you some ticket office updates. Ken Sigmund, our vice chancellor for advancement, will give you an advancement update as well as a campaign update. Teresa Davis, the interim associate VC for alumni relations, will give some updates in regards to alumni relations, and then the Department of Athletics. Mr. Hilton could not be here today, so Katricia, our associate AD for compliance in our SWA, will stand in his place and give some athletic updates as well as some updates on compliance. Okay. So as you all know, we just finished our renewal period that ran from January 1st to March 31st. Our priority purchase period for the season will begin April the 17th, and it'll run for 6 weeks. Here are the dates. April 17th through the 21st will be week one. Week two will be the 24th through the 28th. Week three will be May 1st through the 5th. Week four will be May 8th through the 12th. Week five will be the 15th through the 19th. And week six is designated to our legacy season ticket holders as well as Bill Clark donors that have not gotten in their pledge forms before the deadline on the 31st. Ticket sales and tailgate sales will open up to the general public on June 5th. Cash received during the renewal period, right now we're at $295,000. As compared to last year, where we were at a little bit over $268,000. So we are up almost $30,000 from last year. The number of donor participation. Last year, we had 427 donors to participate in the priority purchase period. This year, we have 444 donors to participate in the priority purchase period. A few donors, a little over 20 donors from last year, but as you all see, the revenue has gone up fairly significantly from last year, so we're very proud of that. Social media initiatives, as you all know, and a lot of you all are on Facebook, have liked us on Facebook, so that's the majority of our demographic, and donors are on Facebook. We have 767 likes compared to the 566 likes that we had last year. So we're getting out there slowly but surely. And of course, we're on Twitter at NCANT_AAF. We currently have 273 followers compared to the 168 followers last year. And of course, that demographic is normally our donors that are around the age between 21 and 25. So that's our younger group of donors that are on Twitter. As you know, we are live streaming on YouTube now, so please follow us on YouTube, and you can also find us on Instagram. We currently have over 1,800 followers on Instagram right now compared to the 1,500 that we had last year. So our followers are growing. Young Alumni Campaign. So we started a new campaign beginning January 1st of this year. This new program is for our recent A&T graduates. These graduates can join the AAF for a reduced rate, but still receive the full benefits of their selected benefit level. And the young alumni will be able to participate in this program for 4 years relative to their year of graduation. So here is a little outline of this particular program. As you all see, the first year is $75 off, second year is $60 off, the third year is $45 off, and then the fourth year is $15 off. And of course, we're just trying to bring in some younger donors to our fold as, and then also to get them in the habit of giving. So we have also offered the student Aggie benefit level free of charge to current students here at A&T as well. Does anybody have any questions so far? All right.
I'll be happy to make it again once it's
Absolutely, absolutely. And we can definitely bring you up towards the end as well. Thank you so much, Teresa. AAF Student Athlete Spotlights, we have introduced the Student Athlete Spotlights last year in October. I know a lot of you all are familiar with the donor spotlights that we used to have, but now we are introducing two student athletes and adding them to our webpage as spotlights. So right now we currently have a female track athlete. Let me see if I can make this a little bit better. As well as a tennis athlete. We started this initiative, like I said, last year around homecoming. So, of course, we introduced a female and a male athlete. We have a few questions that we ask them. They fill out a questionnaire, and then we feature them on our website for around about a month. So, as that's coming up, like I said, this is a new initiative. We used to do a donor spotlight, and so instead of doing a donor spotlight this year, we thought that it would be great to recognize our student athletes. And I will bring this up. I'm having a little difficulty here showing their faces on this particular screen, so I will bring that up later on in the presentation. A few upcoming events that we have: the Metro Atlanta Golf Tournament will be on Saturday, June 3rd in Atlanta. For more information, and Ms. Mary Haynes is in the audience right now, you can give her a call at 770-634-3827. Then we have our D.C. Golf Tournament that will happen at Cross Creek Golf Club on June 23rd, and that is a Friday. For more information, you can call Bill Wills or Butch Blakely, but Bill Wills' number is up here, 301-384-0359. The new AAF benefit structure. As you all know, beginning January 1st, we introduced a new benefit structure. Our AAF fundraising committee conducted benchmarking against other schools to determine how best to streamline benefits to maximize donation opportunities. We evaluated proposed changes based upon feedback and responses from our donor surveys. The new structure allows us to better allocate limited resources, and the benefit levels are now set by a single amount versus ranges. I know a lot of you all can't see it very clearly from here, but this is the new structure. The different changes in the levels include different changes in parking and priority purchase for tailgating and such. So this began in January of the first of this year. Does anybody have any questions about the benefit structure right now? And we will have a Q&A. Come on down. Yep. Come on down. Because they can't see it right there. And someone has a question.
Said you compared amongst other schools.
Yes.
What could you name? What schools you compared to?
So other schools, of course, most of them in UNC system. So Appalachian State, of course, and then ECU was one of the schools that we compared them to. Schools that were similar to ours. Obviously, there's not another A&T out there, and I think we all know that. But schools that have the similar resources, similar benefit structure, similar inventory, similar population of students. Those are the schools that we compared. Compared our, the benefit structures and the inventory to, in order to come up with this particular structure that we came up with.
Was there another MEAC school?
We did look at. And Teresa headed up this this change as well. So
to piggyback,
excuse me,
I'm going to hear
you. Okay. to piggyback on what Shamika just noted. We did survey peer schools in the FCS system as well. And so one of those schools did include Central as part of our comparison, but then some other like ECU, App State, I think we did Western Carolina. I think we did Wilmington, and there was about, gosh, 10 other schools that we compared it to. So it was a thorough analysis. It definitely, when we got to this, there was about a year and a half worth of work before we even got to this point. So that's the answer to the question. Good. Okay, you're welcome.
In addition to what Teresa just said, and I think which is a very, very important point, this information was communicated heavily for a little over a year. We communicated this information at the beginning of last year in our renewal opening letter for our renewal period, as well as our donor meeting last year. We communicated this information as well. And then, of course, the emails that were sent throughout the year. So we did try to prepare everybody for this change that was happening. It was not something that just happened, if you will, overnight. But the reasons I previously gave were those reasons why we decided to go to this benefit structure. Any additional questions? Okay. This is a picture of our old scoreboard coming down, and I just wanted to briefly touch on this. As you all know, the AAF is funding the new scoreboard and Corbett Sports Arena. So as you can see, they are in process, and they are taking this down. They're redoing the floors. They're redoing the ceiling in order to prepare for the new scoreboard that will be put up. And we're hoping to have this scoreboard up by the summer of this year. So they are in process. I know a lot of people had questions about that. When is it going to happen? I thought it was going to be here a certain time. So they are in the process of removing this one. So we will have a new scoreboard in Corbett by the 2017-18 basketball season. Okay. Any questions about the Aggie Athletic Foundation updates? Any comments? Anything at all? Well, moving right along to our governance update, and this is going to just be a brief report. Of course, this is our AAF mission statement. I'm not going to read it to you, but it's located on all our materials. Our website is located everywhere, so that is our mission statement. And here are our current board of directors. Just to give you a little information about our board of directors, we are downsizing our board from a 21-person board to a 17-person board. So as you can see, we have a few people that will be rolling off the board as of June 30th of this year. So we're only going to be filling three seats, and that would put us at the 17-member mark at that time. And this is just a brief overview of our revenue and expense summary as of last fiscal year. Again, we have reached over $500,000 in revenue. Our athletic contributions was $347,053 for the last fiscal year. Program expenses, and program expenses are our donor system, our New Lion donor system, and our donor stewardship events, totaled $77,696. And our operating expenses, any legal and professional fees that we have for our audit or any administrative fees that we need to run the day-to-day operations of the Aggie Athletic Foundation totaled $121,858. Total expenses was $546,608, with a net surplus for that fiscal year of $10,824. Any questions? Okay. No questions? Okay, well, we're just gonna move right along. I have Kiana from the ticket office. She's gonna come up and give a brief update on some ticket office procedures and policies that will be taking place this year. So let's welcome Kiana, our ticket office manager.
Good morning, everyone. I am Kiana Taylor, the ticket office manager, and along with me, I have the assistant ticket office manager, Corbin Bradford.
Hi, everyone.
And the presentation that we're going to present to you today is pretty much questions that we've received thus far concerning the football game day ticket operations. Our first slide, how can tickets be purchased? Beginning April the 17th starts the AAF priority period. And this is when we allow for season books to be purchased as well as season tailgate passes. And they will be available during your priority period. Shamika, she actually submits the list for us for each week. So you will be allowed to purchase your season books as well as season tailgate passes only in your designated period. Season books can be purchased in person at our ticket office location in Brown Hall, or you can give us a call by phone, and the phone number is listed, as well as our website, ncataggies.com. Tailgate passes for lots A3 and A4 can only be purchased in person or by phone. We do not actually have tailgate passes on our website. The cost this year for season books, tailgate spaces, as well as parking is as follows. Season books will remain the same at $198, and that includes taxes and fees. Season tailgate spaces this year will be $250 for both A3 as well as A4. In the past, A4 has been $225, but the committee has decided that both of them will have the same prices this year. And season RV tailgate spaces will remain the same at $300 per space in lot A4. New this year, we already have designated parking spaces, which are for a fee of $10 per space, and that is War Memorial as well as Laurel Street. The only time Laurel Street will not be, we will not be taking payments for Laurel Street, is on homecoming, because we sell it completely out for game day tailgating. And this year, in addition to War Memorial and Laurel Street, Craig Hall, which is the ADA lot, will also cost $10. Where can tickets be purchased on game day? Individual tickets can be purchased at the following location, which is Sullivan Street, which is the ticket booth, right in front of the Science Hall, as well as ncataggies.com. The ticket office usually is not open on game day. You may ask, where will tickets be accepted on game day? Season books and individual tickets will be accepted at the following locations. That's the main gate on Sullivan Street, and it's a pedestrian gate only. Then we have Sullivan and Bimbo Street, which is the student gate. However, if you happen to park on that side of campus, we will accept your season book at that particular gate or ticket. And then we have lot A3, which is the pedestrian and vehicular traffic gate. And then lot A4, which is the A4 vehicular only. And the reason that we don't allow, or do we prefer not to allow persons to, we don't accept tickets at that particular lot, is because for safety reasons. There's not like a side gate. So we just ask that you please, you know, just understand that we can't allow you to walk up, because, you know, people are traveling, you know, in their cars as well as gators and golf carts, and we don't want anybody to be injured. However, we do want you to remember that when you do come through with your tailgating passes in lots A3 and A4, we ask that you enter the stadium the way you're accustomed to on Bessemer Avenue, which is at the intersection of Lindsay. And that we ask that your tailgate passes be visible to us. And please note that all passengers in the vehicle must have a ticket. What are the fees associated with the purchase of season book and tailgate spaces? Taxes and processing fees are included in the purchase of every season book as well as every individual game. Tailgating is excluded from taxes. So the additional fees is, if we hold the tickets for you in will call, is $6. For mailing, it's $9. If you do online tickets through our website, then there's additional $4 charge, which that only applies to individual tickets. And then if you actually come in physically to the office, then there are no additional fees outside of the taxes and the fees like in your season book. So $198, then you will not be assessed any other fees. Are there any questions? Yes.
In regards to the tailgating.
Yes, sir.
$250 is a lot of money for a small spot.
Okay.
Unless you come in a Volkswagen, you don't really have a tailgate spot.
Okay.
So I would really like for you all to take in consideration. That is a lot of money. No, the reality of it is that when we tailgate, we add a lot to this university. It helps with recruiting. People come from all over the United States. And we entertain by feeding, by building relationships. So it's not just that we want to just come and just act, you know, like we're still teenagers. But take in consideration, you know, a lot of us are retired. And we just don't just fork out money, you know, just for the sake of just giving money. So please take that in consideration as you continue to look at increasing the prices and giving us a space that's worthy to be called tailgating.
Yes, sir.
All right.
We'll take your concerns back to our committee. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I have one. I think I can talk loud enough without having to go down to the microphone. In years past, you've had problems with if you gave a certain amount and you had a bargain space and said you could get to the game at any time and it could be there. That wasn't always the case. That be the case this year.
If you had a priority, so you've had issues with being able to actually access your space?
Yes, not tailgating space.
Okay, let me defer this question to Shamika.
And could you repeat the question for folks on YouTube just in case they weren't able to hear that question?
So what, if I understand correctly, what he's asking is that he has priority to have a parking space on Sullivan Street.
Yes.
Because you've donated the amount to allow you to have that space, and he states that he's not able to park there once he gets there. So I'm going to defer the question to Shamika.
Thank you, Kiana. Before I answer that question, is there any more questions for the ticket office? Let me take your question first, and I will address your question after that. Okay. If you don't mind, if you would please come up to the microphone so those that are online can hear your questions, and you can follow behind him, Mr. Hedgebath.
My question goes to, I received a letter the other day regarding Gold Helmet memberships, and that they're processing over into a new card because of new software and all that, which is fine. But it had a statement on there where they wanted the Gold Helmet members who had passed on, who had given their tickets to Ken or whoever they left it to bring a notarized statement from stating that the transfer was a transfer had been done to another relative. I'm trying to figure out who we're supposed to get this notarized statement from. If the person is deceased, what good is the notarized statement? Because all you're presenting is a notarized statement saying, I own these tickets, so this person has died and left me these tickets. I'm not exactly sure what it is you're looking for.
The original letter was actually written by our athletic director. He's the one who sent the letter out. And what he's asking for, like if you had a notarized letter previously from someone who is now deceased, if you would just bring that information in, we can make a copy of it, and then we'll submit all the Gold Helmet cards, your concerns and any questions to him, and then he will be directed on how those Gold Helmet cards will be issued. So if you have any other questions or concerns,
yeah, there's still a problem with that. If the person's deceased, how are they going to write a letter?
So you're saying if the person is deceased, the only thing, the way we're handling it in the ticket office, we're just taking the cards from each of the Gold Helmet members. So any concerns, we're actually documenting that information and we're actually submitting it to him, and then he's presenting it to our legal team. So whatever concerns you have, then you can just bring them to us, or you can just let us know, and then, you know, we'll do it, take care of it on a case-by-case basis.
And this is not a question for the ticket office, essentially. This is going to be a question for our athletics director. So I'll be more than happy to get your contact information, and then that way we can address your question to the appropriate person to let you know the history behind the decision that was made and the information that's needed for Gold Helmet.
Okay?
All right.
My question is not to the ticket office, but to the board. Okay, you donate $1,000 and you get a tailgate for $250. So to the general public, you sell it for $252. Why wouldn't you go up and sell to the general public, sell $400 and sell it at a discount to me for $250 on the tailgate? What's the advantage of being an Aggie club if you can buy the tailgate for $250 like I can?
So the Aggie Athletic Foundation itself does not have any type of say over the amount of the actual tailgating spot. You know, if we could definitely maybe moving forward discuss some options moving forward in the future. But as we sit right now, the spots are set at the $250 for both A3 and A4. Like I said, we can definitely discuss it. I can bring it back to our committee.
Okay. I don't think you understand my question.
No, I understand your question. You give $1,000.
Yeah.
And we offer tailgating spots to you for as a donor, as well as to the general public at the same price, correct?
Yeah.
And so what I'm saying is that tailgating is set. The price is actually set. But moving forward, if there's some ideas on how to maybe give some type of, you know, discount to our donors or something like that moving forward, this is something that I can definitely bring back to our committee to discuss. But as we sit right now for this particular football season, those prices will remain at the $250.
Okay. Have you, the board, considered senior citizens, season books, general mission, or general mission?
So I think there's I think you're thinking that the board sets the prices for our AAF board sets the prices for tailgating and season books and that sort of thing. Our board does not set the prices for those. That comes university side. So however, we all do meet collectively and we sit down and we discuss these things. So moving forward, I can bring your concern to that committee and then we can discuss the different suggestions that you have and possibly setting different reduced prices.
Shamika, the tailgate level went up to 1,000.
It did. Yes.
Yes,
the tailgating level did. In order to have the priority to purchase tailgating this year, it has gone up from $500 last year to $1,000 this year, and that is a part of the new benefit structure. Yes.
The general public can't buy the tailgating at the same time that the person gets $1,000.
That is correct. The general public can purchase their season books June 5th. We open it up. June 1st. However, our priority purchase period runs from April 17th through the 26th of May. So during that time, and of course we send out letters, you all receive phone calls letting you know when your respective weeks are based upon your points in the ranking. To address the gentleman's question up there in regards to Sullivan Street parking, I do know that there was a little chaos last year as regards to parking on Sullivan Street. Cars left overnight, even though there is a lot of signage stating to move your cars the night before and that sort of thing. So we have addressed that, and I did bring your concerns to our committee. And so now we have had a resolve on that. We will have tighter security that will be there around the clock, and then we will have the option. A lot of those cars are student cars from the night before, so of course we don't want to assess a lot of towing fees to our students. So we have identified a way to move their cars somewhere on campus. Should they still be there after that deadline in order to allow our AAF donors to park in their particular areas on Sullivan Street. So yes, we have addressed that question. So moving forward, I don't foresee that being an issue this year. Any other questions?
When would the ticket purchasing information go out?
So that will go out this week. So Monday the 10th. Between Monday and Tuesday, that'll go out. And the reason why it does not go out immediately, and I know a lot of you all addressed why can't I get my letter early, or why do we wait a week before? That's why we implemented the actual calls, because remember, we are still waiting for mail to come in, for those that choose to mail in their donations, of course, postmarked by the 31st. But we want to have the opportunity to make sure that we receive those checks that come in by the 31st, enter those checks in. So there is a process. So by the time that's all said and done, it's normally around this time, the 10th or 11th or so, before we can really rank everybody and send their letters out and let them know when they can purchase their season books and or tailgating if they're eligible. Any other questions? Yes. So that is actually more of a, and her question was, is it possible for us to increase the size of the tailgating space? That is a more of a game operations type question for our game operations person. I can't say one way or the other. However, these are definitely questions that I can bring back. And once I have an answer to that, I can let you know. But just moving forward for the 2017 football season, I think it's just important. What's set right now is what's going to be set for the 2017 season. However, we do take your concerns, your suggestions, and everything, and we do meet collectively as a university in our athletics department, our ticket department, and, of course, me representing the Aggie Athletic Foundation. And I do take these concerns back to those group of people and, you know, bring them back to them, we discuss it, and then if we can come up with some type of resolve, we do so. Any other questions for the ticket office? Parking? All right. Thank you so much, Kiana.
Thank you.
All right. Moving forward to our advancement update is our Vice Chancellor for Advancement, Mr. Kenneth Sigman.
Here you go. Thank you, Shemika.
You're welcome.
Well, good morning. How are y'all doing?
Good morning.
Good. Well, thank you for being here. Do I have to stand really close to this mic? I hate standing behind a podium. But thank you for all you're doing for Aggie Athletics as well. I thought I'd take a few minutes this morning to give you an update on our advancement division, which we are pretty much rebuilding from scratch, as well as where we're at in the campaign, because you all are important members of this campaign as well, because of not only the Aggie Athletic Foundation and its role in supporting the campaign in athletics, but your role as a donor as well. So I want to give you some updates there. So, all right, that one's not mine. I went the wrong way. Sorry. So first of all, when I got here about 2 years ago, the chancellor, and you know the chancellor, he can be a pretty persuasive guy, particularly since he's my boss, said, "We're in a campaign." And I said, "Well, really?" I looked around. There was about 10 people in the office. And to run a campaign of this magnitude and this scope requires a whole lot of people doing a lot of different things, from individual gifts to corporate and foundation gifts to plan giving and working with deans and everyone else. So in the past roughly year, we've appointed about 17 people to new positions. So we had 22 of our 28 full-time positions are now filled, so we're about 80%. We still have a few critical positions to see there. You know, Teresa Davis is serving as our interim Associate Vice Chancellor for Alumni Relations and Executive Director of the Alumni Association. That search is going on now, and really all these searches are going on now. So we fully expect by the end of this fiscal year to be in a much better position to run a campaign. So you've heard probably the phrase before, but we always describe this as building the bicycle as we ride it. So after I pulled myself up off the floor after the chancellor talking about a campaign, we got to work to really putting the kind of infrastructure in place. So we're in a much better place in terms of our staffing. And in terms of the campaign itself, I want to touch a little bit on sort of why the campaign and some of our areas of need. Obviously, it's a very competitive world out there now in terms of students getting the best faculty in here, having the kind of facilities and programs that are required of a top-tier research institution, which we are now. And so we compete in a totally different environment now for all of those kind of things. And our peer group has changed considerably, not only within the state, around the UNCGs and East Carolinas and UNC Charlotte's of the world, but also outside of the state as well, when you start looking at top-tier research institutions. So obviously for us, one of the priority areas is enrollment. You know, providing the kind of financial support that is needed, both merit and need-based, for attracting and retaining very top-notch students. And that includes student-athletes as well. So you all play a critical role in that. Touched on faculty as well, making sure, because we are a research institution and produce about $60 million a year in research grants and funding, that we have the faculty and staff of the future that are going to support Preeminence 2020 and the goals of the university going forward. So we have a plan in place to build the criteria for our faculty and staff of the future. And as we retire, because we're starting to see more and more retirements of our faculty, making sure that we are thinking long term about what the university needs to look like in 2020 and beyond, and getting those kind of people in place, as well as some of the non-tenure track instructors that are used throughout the colleges as well. Certainly enhancing our institutional brand and competitiveness. You don't have to look very far back to see how we have enhanced the brand of the institution and getting the name out there more. We just had Mark Zuckerberg on campus. Of course, President Obama was here. Certainly doesn't get much better than that in terms of the kind of publicity and press we get and raising the prestige of the university. And changing our academic structure. Many of you may know we've rebranded and restructured some of our colleges to not only make them more competitive for students, but also for research funding, as well as faculty as well, and trying to build some of those sort of university-wide collaborations for the next phase of the university. Looking at new and revised academic degree programs, we know those are always changing too. Those can't remain static. We have to keep adapting to the world, and we know as technology changes, that requires new academic degree programs. And then those kind of things that are what we sometimes consider extracurricular, but also are things that our students and faculty and the world is looking for when we produce graduates, and that is things like entrepreneurship, giving them global experiences so that their world's not just limited to where they came from and their experience here at A&T, but opening them up to the greater world. Leadership development, we know that that's critical for the future as well. And then certainly preparing them for a career. Obviously, that's one of the reasons they're coming to A&T. Investments in our campus infrastructure, providing more classrooms and auditoriums like this that have modern technology. And you go in this classroom or you go to the College of Business, your classroom may look a lot different than if you were in College of Arts and Sciences, which may not have the equivalent kind of technology. So we need to make sure that our students around the campus experience the same kind of education, have the same experiences, and have the same technology as well. So we've got some opportunities there to enhance our technology, and as you know too, that continues to have a short lifespan and is constantly being upgraded as well. So that's another critical area of need for us in the campaign. And of course, athletic competition. It's just another aspect of the university and university life and what that brings to the university as well. We all know how winning national championships support the university overall in terms of fundraising, in terms of student recruiting, in terms of enhancing the brand, winning the Celebration Bowl, having a national championship in bowling, the success of track and field, things like that. Certainly help in all of these areas. So we need to make sure that we're putting investments in student-athlete scholarships, in our coaches and the staff that support athletics, as well as investment in our athletic facilities, making sure that they're not only competitive in recruiting student-athletes, but then also are very forward-looking as well to make sure that they're going to stay that way for the long term. And of course, we don't do this just for those reasons we stated, but obviously we want the outcomes that these private kind of investments bring around a campaign, and that is enhancing our graduation rates, making sure that we're competitive there. It's one of the things that we as a university are going to become more and more measured on from the university system level, looking at career placement, making sure that our graduates are prepared for the workplace when they leave here. Growing our enrollment growth funding from the state. We've seen how it enhances some of our competitors, and so we need to make sure that our enrollment growth continues as well. We have a goal of 15,000 in preeminence 2020. We're just a little over 11,000 students now, so we're back on a growth track in terms of our enrollment, and we're starting to see some of the benefits of that as well. Academic and student success, making sure we're giving them all the tools that while they're here, to give them all those extracurricular activities, but also the experiences in the classroom that are going to set them up for success as they graduate. Looking at our national rankings and recognition, people either love or hate these kind of things, but a lot of students and their parents make decisions based on those national rankings and the brand of the university. So we're going to continue to focus on the things that help drive those national rankings, but then also drive the awareness of and the recognition of the university. Just touched briefly on athletic championships. If we make those kind of investments, we hope to see more success in athletics. Thanks to you all and the support you've given in the past, you've really set us up well for success on the field of competition. But we want to continue to see that success because, again, drives the university overall as well. World-class faculty and staff, making sure we have those preeminent scholars who can not only bring in students and help deliver new programs, but also help drive our research initiatives too. And then leadership development, seeing more and more of our students take leadership roles and get that kind of leadership training and development here on campus where it's a little bit of a safer environment before they get out into the real world, but making sure that they know the environment they're going into and they're prepared for it. So we look at the campaign. We have a funding goal right now. We call this a working goal because it's not set in stone yet until we get to the public phase of the campaign. But right now we're working on a goal of about $85 million, and that's driven by taking, obviously, the overall needs of the university, which far exceed $85 million, and whittling that down to which ones are the priorities, as well as what do we think we can raise in terms of private dollars over the period of the campaign. And as we touched on before, overwhelmingly, student support is our number one priority right now. That's $55 million, of this campaign. And then along with our faculty and staff who teach them, we talked about technology and then those programs as well. So we consider these really to be the cornerstone of the success of the university. And, of course, all this includes athletics as well. We talk about this as a comprehensive campaign because it means that it touches all types of giving, it touches all types of donors, and it certainly touches all the corners of the campus. So as of March 31st, we have surpassed the halfway point, so we have raised almost $43 million. We have far surpassed our program support goal due to what we have typically had is very generous corporate and foundation support every year. Doesn't necessarily grow endowments, this big piece down here, but certainly provides a lot of that support for the kind of programs that we need. Some of the other things that are real important here that are benchmarks for us, not just outside the dollar goals, but how, what is the direct impact of the campaign? Rather than just talking about, well, we've raised $85 million, but what has that done for us? So we look at some other benchmarks like how many new endowed scholarships have we created? How many new endowed chairs and professorships have we created? Because those are now investments in perpetuity in the university. And with good stewardship, they're going to grow over time and they're going to provide ever-increasing levels of support for these kind of programs. So we've increased by almost a third now the number of endowed scholarships we've had. So that not only impacts almost 90 students, because some of those support multiple students. So having a great impact on the number of students who are now receiving some form of either need or merit-based scholarship support. And then endowed chairs and professorships. We talked about recruiting the faculty of the future, which kind of funding is required to provide startup funds for researchers and their facilities for recruiting some of the best and brightest to the university. Again, not only feeds into our role in education, but also in research, extension, engagement, and some of the people that we're bringing in on something like Kellogg Foundation and some of those kind of professorships are really changing the game for us. You've seen some of the things around the sort of non-aspirin or an alternative to aspirin-based medications, the hypoallergenic peanut, some of those kind of things, which really, again, help drive a lot of the things in the university that we're looking for. Deferred commitments, a little over $1 million. We've rebuilt our planned giving program, so people that include us in their estates and their estate plans, whether it's through a simple bequest or a beneficiary in a life insurance policy or a charitable remainder trust, we've closed about $1 million of those. And then over $13,000 donors to date to the campaign. So we're making good progress. We certainly appreciate your support because Aggie Athletics plays a big role in this as well. I want to touch just briefly on the timeline we set. So obviously we're in the phase where we are looking at leadership principal gifts, kick off the campaign hopefully in the next couple of years when we go public. And that's where we'll really put a stake in the ground around a dollar goal and let the world know that we are in a campaign because we are in the basically the silent phase, as we like to call it, campaign right now. So Chancellor and I and the team are really working hard on identifying and cultivating, soliciting some of those lead and major gifts to the campaign, those gifts of anywhere from $500,000 up to $5-10 million, and having some of those conversations now. We'll continue to build our fundraising capacity at all levels, from everything from the $25 gift from the young alum all the way up through planned gifts that are $1 million or more to the university. And as I mentioned, we call it a working goal because we're going to be trying to drive towards a $65-70 million mark before we would put a stake in the ground around an actual goal, because that goal can change. It can go up or down based on how successful we are in the next couple of years before we go public with the campaign and let the world know what our goal is. And right now, working with volunteer boards, much like the AAF board, to garner 100% participation by our volunteer leadership. We've talked about this as a kind of a top-down, inside-out solicitation strategy where we get all of our volunteer leadership on board with their gifts before we start asking others to do that. So we've certainly, like we've done with the boards, encourage you all to think about what kind of impact you can have through the campaign with a gift to the campaign. And then certainly be an advocate in helping the AAF drive other people to the table to talk about supporting Aggie Athletics or something within the university. So I'm happy to take any questions, but before I certainly step down, I'd certainly love to say thank you for all you have done for Aggie Athletics and the university, what you're currently doing, certainly by your presence here today, but what I know you will do for us in the future, because this is critically important, not only to athletics, but to the university overall. So thank you. Any questions? Yes, sir.
If the $43 million cash falls, a lot of in-kind contributions.
Yeah, I don't have that report here, but this is overwhelmingly cash. One of the things we've done in this campaign is to make sure that, and I go back to this slide, one of the reasons we track this deferred commitments number is we want to make sure that this campaign is having a current impact on the campaign. So the majority of this roughly $43 million that's been raised to date has been either in current gifts or in five-year pledges to the campaign that we're receiving the benefit of those over the next 5 years. We're trying to limit the amount of deferred gifts in the campaign. We don't want to see it grow to any more than about 20% of the overall goal. And in keeping in kind, although we count it, keeping that at a minimum as well. Hard to spend in kind. Good question, though. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you all very much. I certainly appreciate being here.
Thank you, Mr. Sigmund. Next, we'll bring up Teresa Davis. Teresa Davis is the interim associate vice chancellor for alumni relations and the executive director of the Alumni Association. Teresa is one of the Aggie Athletic Foundation's past presidents. Well, she was just past board chair. Excuse me. So she's here kind of in a twofold position right now. So she will talk about alumni relations, as well as touch a little bit on the AAF board as well.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Aggie Pride.
Aggie Pride.
You know I can't get up in front of y'all without saying that, so thank you all for indulging me. So just as a point of privilege, being a past board chair, I would, and Shamika indicated it earlier, how the board is downsizing to 17 members. But I would like to recognize those members that are rolling off that have been there since the beginning and being great champions and advocates of not only the Aggie Athletic Foundation through its transition, but then also helping to uplift our athletics department and our student athletes and taking it to the next level, because that's what we wanted to do when the Aggie Athletic Foundation was established. So I'm going off of memory, so charge it to my head, not my heart, in terms of the members that will be rolling off. So it's Jim Pender. Jim Pender has been there since the beginning. Bill Wills, is Bill here? Bill Wills. Leroy Roberts, Dr. Leroy Roberts, I don't think he's here. And of course, last but not least, Mr. Joe Parker, who was our original board chair, who laid the foundation in terms of the purpose of this Aggie Athletic Foundation and the spirit of it as well, and who's also a dear friend to me, but also served as a guide in terms of what a good leader would be and how you can remain calm in difficult times. So thank you, Joe, so much for that. So if you would, please join me in giving these individuals a round of applause for getting us to the point of where we are. All right, now on to business. Oh, I have the little clicker thing. So here in the Office of Alumni Relations, I'm back. In the Office of Alumni Relations, our goal has been and always will be to connect, engage, and inform you as our alumni, as our main constituent, or one of our main constituents here at North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University. And we do that in various ways and in different programs that we have coming through the Office of Alumni Relations and the North Carolina A&T State University Alumni Association, whose board chair is Pamela Bunkum, and I bring you greetings on behalf of Pam as well. So what I'm going to go over is just a handful of things in terms of what's going on through, round, about, in the Office of Alumni Relations and the North Carolina A&T State University Alumni Association. So the closest thing in the short term that we have coming up is the Alumni Reunion Weekend 2017. If you are in a class ending in a 2 or a 7, you are in reunion, and I'm hoping that you did receive your registration information by now and that you have registered by now to come in and enjoy us for another wonderful weekend of celebration, reminiscing, and fellowshipping with all of our class reunion celebrants, as well as enjoying the different changes going on at the university. Even if you are not in reunion this year, we welcome you to come on back and enjoy the time with us. So a few things that's going on at the reunion weekend. Our headquarters hotel, again, would be the Greensboro Downtown Marriott. We also will be hosting the graduate breakfast, which happens on Friday morning, May 12th. We will also have that same day our Society of Golden Aggies luncheon. Of course, our golden class this year is the class of 1967. And they will be inducted into the Society of Golden Aggies, and we're looking forward to that. That evening, we will have just before the annual meeting, we will have our chapter president's forum happening at 3 o'clock on Friday. And then we will have our annual meeting of the Alumni Association. And again, you are all welcome to come out and hear updates from the board of directors for the past, what things that have been going on for the past year with the Alumni Association. So that's happening at 6 o'clock at the Greensboro Marriott downtown on Friday, May 12th. We will also have our Alumni Awards and Class Reunion Banquet on Saturday. I don't know if you guys heard about it last year, but it was a banging good time, and a lot of people didn't want to leave the dance floor when we had to shut down the room, but it's okay because that's what Alumni Reunion Weekend is about. Is having a good time and fellowshipping. As part of that Alumni Awards banquet and the class reunion banquet, we will be recognizing two alums with awards. So the first one that you see there is our Howard C. Barnhill Distinguished Service honoree. That is Mrs. Catherine Simmons, class of 94. Congratulations, Catherine. And our honoree for the Velmar Spate Young Alumna Award is Miss Jasmine Gurley, class of 2012. Miss Jasmine is a former Miss A&T, and we are really excited having Jasmine be recognized as the Velmar Spate Young Alumna Awardee this year. Registration for Alumni Weekend closes April 15th, so you have plenty of time to get in your registration form. And make your reservations at the Greensboro Downtown Marriott before all the rooms are booked. Another thing that we're doing that the Alumni Association is embarking on is something that's really exciting opportunity for us is that we are embarking on having an inaugural convention, alumni convention. So doing things a little bit differently in terms of our outreach and engagement of alumni and raising money for our beloved university. So our convention, the convention is planned for June 6th through 10th, 2018 in Atlanta, Georgia. And you see there our objective, as I mentioned earlier, staying connected, engaged, and informed. And our goals in terms of increasing the membership of the association, engagement in the association, increasing alumni giving, and also increasing our revenue stream for our National Alumni Scholars Program. Is going to be an awesome time. We are in the throes of planning right now. If you have not seen it already, in the March edition of the Alumni Times, we put out a call for convention volunteers. We would love to have your help. The more, the merrier. It would be wonderful to paint Atlanta in blue and gold once again, like we did a couple of years ago. And they are looking forward to having us again. They know the name North Carolina A&T State University very well. In Atlanta, Georgia. So welcome you to go out there in the Alumni Times. It'll also be in the April edition of the Alumni Times if you are interested in being a part of the planning activities. This is going to be an awesome affair for the Alumni Association, and it is a huge undertaking, but it will be well worth it in the end in terms of broadening our reach to you and appealing to you as our alumni. Next up, of course, you all have it already blocked on your calendars, Homecoming 2017, October 6th through 8th this year. Yep, it's a little bit early, and I can tell you right now, we're all feeling it on campus. But again, we are committed to making it another wonderful homecoming, the greatest homecoming on earth, and making sure that everyone who comes into town as we host you, having a good time, having a safe time. As well. So we're looking forward to entertaining you all and having you all around for Homecoming 2017. A couple of the things, and as I was talking about our mission and our goals in terms of engaging, connecting, and informing, what I have up on the screen are just a few of the programs that we are involved in with the Alumni Association and the Office of Alumni Relations. Ooh. First of all is the Aggie Alumni Certified Recruiters Program. Many of you in this room, I know, have taken that, and you are certified to go out and recruit on behalf of North Carolina A&T State University. This program is in its third year, and we have seen a lot of successes with it in terms of being ambassadors or adding ambassadors and partners to our Office of Undergraduate Admissions. As we tried to cover all the different career fairs that goes on, college fairs that goes on across the nation. So thank you all who have participated in this program, and thank you all congratulations to you all who have been certified. By the way, July 1, you would need to become recertified. We do this every year to make sure that you have the most up-to-date information to share with potential students for North Carolina A&T State University. We want to make sure that the correct information and the accurate information is communicated so that no one gets in trouble when you talk about A&T. So be on the lookout for the announcements for those dates that are coming up in our next academic year. And again, we will welcome you. If you have not been involved in this program, it is an awesome program. We will welcome you to become involved with us here. Next, the Young Alumni Council. Young Alumni Council is another arm of the Alumni Association, where we reach out to or engage folks in that span of 20 years or less in terms of having graduated from North Carolina A&T State University. That has been a huge gap over the years in terms of, you know, once individuals leave A&T, then we may not hear or see them for another 20 or 30 years. So this is an opportunity to fill that gap. And to engage in programs that appeal to our young alums. So the council, some of the programs, or a couple of the programs that the council has been involved in, the Week of Aggie Love, which occurs the first week in February. We had another awesome week this year, of course, that included the sit-in anniversary celebration on February 1st, but also it included our first Young Alumni Giving Day. Which had wonderful results considering it was our first year around. We exceeded our goals in terms of giving, raised over $7,000 in that one day, and had numerous givers, and I apologize, the number escapes me, but just the fact that, and then a lot of those individuals, I remember this number, 121 of those donors were new givers, were new donors. So it's just the impact of that type of program and making sure that we appeal to all generations of our alumni base is a wonderful thing. But that was a great week. Following that week, we had the I Love My 1891 week, and it was more so a student-centered type event where throughout the week, we had young alums from different industries to come in and speak on different things to students. So one day the young alums were from the education field. The next day we had the young alums from the corporate field. And then another day we had representatives from the law enforcement and civic service field. And the fourth day we had entrepreneurship. So each of those days was 4 days running. We averaged 35 to 40 students attending. The students were very engaged, as well as the alums that were involved in it. So another wonderful program in terms of making that connection between young alums and the students here. Next, we have the Aggie Student Alumni Association. I talked about the gap that we fill with the Young Alumni Council in terms of our graduates who finished 20 years or before or earlier. But then now we also want to start cultivating that mindset with the students while they're here on campus. So we have the Aggie Student Alumni Association to start building that mindset of how to be a good alumnus or alumna once you walk across that stage with your graduation year. So with the Aggie Student Alumni Association, one of their main programs is around class traditions. And it's a program where there is some type of activity or unifying activity for the new students, the sophomore class, the junior class, and the senior class. Senior class is the cap decoration event. So that's coming up in a couple of weeks here. And we have it, of course, before each commencement ceremony. For the juniors, and we did it for the first time for the juniors this year, or a couple of weeks ago, it's called Life After A&T. So the juniors were able to come in. We provided free professional headshots. We had the financial aid office in there talking about, okay, this is what you need to think about once you graduate. So it'll be one less thing that they will have to prepare for in their senior year, talking about how they're going to manage their loans or how they're going to manage their finances, yada, yada, yada. So we had financial aid there. And then we also had career services there, giving mock interviews, reviewing resumes, and all that good little stuff to prepare our students for life after A&T, and it was a great event. We didn't have as many students this year, but that's okay because it's the first year. But next year we are looking forward to being bigger and better. The sophomore tradition is the sophomore Olympics. Unfortunately, last year we weren't able to pull that through because of weather and logistical challenges. But essentially, the sophomore tradition is kind of like Olympics and the sporting type atmosphere. So we're looking forward to having that whenever we can have that, and definitely we're shooting for next year. And then for new students, notice I say, well, I don't say freshman class, because when students come in, they can be transfer students as well. So we want to make sure that we're involving everyone. So the new student tradition during Welcome Week is that it's called in the Zone, and where we have everyone to come into Aggie Stadium, and we take a nice group shot of all of the students. And we're talking a lot of students there, and then they all get a picture of that to help remember their first day on campus. So again, the Aggie Student Alumni Association, that's one of their main things, and we're really looking forward to the possibilities with that organization. And then the last thing is, and this is something that we're working on, with the number of requests that we've seen in the office in terms of alumni tours. People just want to come on campus and check everything out with the transformation that's been happening on campus. So we've had a couple of test runs this year, and so we're continuing to refine it, but we think it's a great opportunity to, again, connect with our alums who haven't been around in a while, and welcoming and hosting them on campus and taking them around to show them all the wonderful things that's happening on campus. So be on the lookout as we refine that and formalize that program. So that's just a handful of some of the things that's going on in alumni relations and the Alumni Association. What questions do you have? All right, well, thank you all so much, and have a great time at the game, spring game. And again, Aggie Pride.
Aggie Pride.
Thank you so much, Teresa. Next up is going to be our Department of Athletics update, as well as compliance update. Katricia is here to speak on behalf of Mr. Hilton, who was unable to be with us today, and then she will speak on her area as well of compliance. So here is Katricia.
All right. Good morning.
Good morning.
Got some important information to discuss with you. So I just have three areas that we want to cover today. Recruiting 101. I know that you are passionate alumni and you always have great recruits for us. We're going to talk a little bit about that so you can know a little bit more about how we recruit, the way we want to recruit, and what happens when a recruit comes onto campus here at A&T. We're going to talk about athletic grant aid. I can't tell you how many emails we get, and they say, well, how come this kid went across town? How much money did we offer him? We're going to talk exactly about those dollars today. And then for the final phase, we're going to talk about booster, what happened. So what happened when a booster did what somewhere else? Here we go. We always want to go over our mission statement. Even though we are an athletic department, our mission is integrated into the fabric of the university. So we work hand in hand. So a lot of times when I'm giving speeches, I always say, like, we have that interlock of the A&T. Athletics is interlocked with the university. We are one and the same. National letter of intent. So right now is our all sports or other sports national letter of intent going on. The way it works is that when a student athlete is recruited to a university, they sign a national letter of intent, and they also sign athletic grant aid. So you'll see on television when you have the guy sitting at a table and they have all the different hats, and they say, I'm gonna go to which school, and they put on that hat, and everybody starts clapping and crying, like, I knew he was gonna go to that school. So that's a national letter of intent. That has grown into so much more. It's more commercialized, it's more on social media. It used to be just someone signing a page in their high school coach's office and faxing it into a college. Now it's much more, it has much more media attention to that. What is the purpose of that? Well, the purpose of that is that we try to get student athletes to sign a national letter of intent during the early signing period, because that puts a recruiting ban on them. So once they sign that, that's a written document that means that no other school can recruit them. So it's important that we also offer them aid as required by the national letter of intent. We also get them to sign early. For example, in football, we have our early signing period and we have our signing day. We get those football players to sign early. Why? In February, so they can continue their senior year and not have to be bombarded by other schools recruiting them. So once they sign that, we know that they're ours. They're coming to North Carolina A&T. That also means they have to finish all of their high school requirements. So they are coming here, but they still have to do what? Graduate from high school, take their ACTs, SATs, apply for admission, all those other wonderful things, but it's just a document to show that they are coming to North Carolina A&T. So far, this is what we have tabulated thus far. We know that we're constantly getting student athletes in. This does not also include our transfers who came in earlier, so our mid-year enrollees. We're talking about new students that are coming straight out of high school for the National Letter of Intent. So here's a graph, and we try to get a bird's eye view of where A&T is in comparison to other FCS Division I schools. The bottom green line, does this have the pointer on it? Uh-oh. I thought it did. Well, I'm going to point with my finger. How about that? So the green line here is the Mideastern Athletic Conference. When we talk about in comparison to the GPAs and the high school core GPAs, this is where the MEAC signs. The thick black line is North Carolina A&T. The line at the top is all division schools, and the gold line underneath that is the FCS schools. So we can see that we're trending up. That means that we're getting higher caliber student athletes and students entering A&T. We're also pushing that we also have the best student and athlete at that time. So as you can see, since 2011, we are trending up. We're also offering more scholarships because we also have more students that are able to qualify for them. So what is an athletic scholarship? What does that cover? So we know how that works. We say tuition and fees, room and board, which is housing and meals, because now student athletes may not know what room and board is. Books is just a placeholder. We do $800 per semester. That's what the NCAA tells us, but we can't go over that. We know that books may cost more than that. And this is how we get the full grant and aid. So when a student athlete says they have a full scholarship for in-state, these are the dollars that we're looking at. Out of state, we can also see that jump there. So when we look at the scholarship dollars it takes to come to North Carolina A&T, this is what our student athletes are getting. Any questions about that? When we look at the number of student athletes receiving athletic aid across the country, again, the black line here is North Carolina A&T. We're trending upward. The dotted green line is the MEAC conference. Now, you have to also look at it, too, when we're looking at across the NCAA. Some schools have more sports, so they have more students, so they can offer more aid. The gold line is FCS, and then the dotted line at the top is all Division I schools. We look at required fees because we know that each school has a different breakdown of tuition and fees. Where does North Carolina A&T hit? We're almost the fourth expensive when it comes to fees. So we say, how much do we pay for? How much of our budget is allocated for scholarships? So we have to pay those tuition and fees. This is where we stand when we look at all of our other UNC system peers. So we can see that our price point is, we're kind of expensive there, but that's also something, a mandated fee that we have to pay when we're offering a scholarship. So let's kind of go into some rules educations. I want to also bring up a point that a lot of times people will say, I know this great recruit. He lives in a certain part of North Carolina. I talked to his mom yesterday at church, and nobody is recruiting him. He is 6'6". He is 230 pounds. He has already been admitted to A&T. Why aren't you guys going after them, okay? We probably get those calls. I probably get at least 10 to 12 of those weekly. We take those names down. We give that to our recruiting coordinator for our sport. The way that works is that it's up to our coaches to decide if they want to contact that recruit. Now, obviously, we love getting the input, and we know that you're giving us this great insight on this great recruit, but that recruit may not be a fit for our program at this time. So that's the way that recruiting process works. The reason why we say that is that we love getting the insight on, I know everyone's looking for that blue chipper, that recruit that no one has seen, but they show up at A&T and they help us win the national championship, right? Sometimes that's how it goes, and sometimes it does not go that way. So let's take an example of, here are some things that happened recently within the NCAA. Now we know that when we're talking about NCAA rules, it's not just for the athletic department. It's not just for the student athlete and coaches. We're all included in that, including everyone sitting in this room. NCAA compliance is everyone's obligation, right? It's a loyalty to one's coworkers, student athletes, athletic boosters, and that's you, right? Question. A PSA has committed or signed the National Letter of Intent. We just talked about that. They signed stating that they're going to come to North Carolina A&T. May an athletics representative visit the PSA's educational establishment without speaking to any individuals? You want to go there to pick up game film, transcripts, and other documentation. What do you think about that? Are you allowed to do that? The answer's already up there. You're acting like the students. Wake up. No, you can't do that. So a lot of times we take great pride in knowing that a student is going to come to A&T. And we think that once that student athlete signs, then he's an A&T person, so we can automatically do things for that. We urge you to lean to our coaches. That's why our coaches are there. They're still in that process of getting information, getting documentation. At no point should any booster or athletic representative go to a high school, pick up a transcript, pick up film, even if you were just passing by, even if you were there and it was laying in front of you, okay? Leave that information to our coaches to pick up. And you'll be surprised. Sometimes people will say, I just wanted to pick it up. I just wanted to help out. I know he's going to be an Aggie. Please defer that to our coaching staff. So this is recently happening at Ole Miss. And it happened with a recruiting visit. So in between March 2014 and January 25th, a former staff member infamously arranged for recruiting inducements in the form of lodging and transportation. So let's say that you are a booster and you own a hotel or, as we say in North Carolina, a bed and breakfast. And you want to help the athletic department out by allowing recruits to stay at your bed and breakfast. We would have to look into some more documentation to see if that would be permissible to do that. But also, if we had a recruit staying there, you couldn't just give that recruit and his parents comp nights and so forth like that. All of those things are impermissible. So we know that people want to help out with the recruiting process. Again, we urge you to let the athletic department handle that. What happened in this situation just as recently as 2014-2015? The NCAA was able to find out that the value of the lodging and transportation between the two student athletes that were being recruited averaged up to $2,000. And also during that time, that same staff member, they facilitated contact between the boosters because that booster was actively recruiting those PSAs to come into that time. This is a level one allegation. So a lot of times people will say, well, no one's going to find out. But the thing is, with these students and these, they put everything on social media. They take a picture. They'll take a picture with the receipt. Look, I got comped. He gave me a free hotel room and showing 000. So these things are easy to find out. What's more importantly is that when the NCAA finds out, it becomes an infraction on the university. When the NCAA comes in, they don't say, oh, it's just the athletic department and this one coach. Our logo goes up. That's national attention that we don't want. That says that it's the university at fault. Also, at the final bullet here, it also says that that same booster gave the recruit money for food and drinks, along with the recruit's companions, in quotations. He also said that it also occurred at the booster's own restaurant. So a lot of times, I'll get a call and say, oh, such and such here, I just want to give him a meal. He did so good in that game. Let that student athlete or that recruit pay for their own meal. So this is why a lot of times I know you may work with Shamik and you'll say, oh, I know that the team is coming through to D.C. We want to make sure that we provide that team with a meal. That's why we have a process. We have to go through a process where you are writing down how you want that meal to be handled. And we know that meal can only take place in someone's home. This is why it can't happen in a restaurant, because we want to make sure that the student athletes, the recruits, and the coaches aren't getting kickbacks from those restaurants. Here's another example of what happened. Booster, what happened? The SMU golf coach for 4 months was contacting a booster, and they arranged their own unofficial visits to the university. So this is where a booster said, well, if they don't have time to recruit you, I'm going to bring you on campus myself, and I'm going to show you around. Okay? So that would be outside of an alumni tour that Teresa's talking about setting up. We're talking about where someone is specifically recruiting a recruit to come on campus to play a sport and giving them their own tour, which is impermissible. The penalties that that school had to endure because of that is a 3-year reduction of scholarships, public reprimand, loss of apparel and merchandise sales, and also a 5-year show cause. So that means wherever that coach goes for the next 5 years, he has to go before a committee so that committee could decide if he can be hired somewhere else. So what we're seeing here is just the nice gesture to step out and do something in the name of being an advantageous alumni or a booster can also have implications for years, even beyond that recruit not being there, to impact A&T. So we ask you and we urge you to always ask before you act. Are there any questions? Yes, sir.
Baseball
signing right now.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Very good question. All right. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Katricia. Just a few things before we close out. One, I wanted to recognize somebody that will be working closely, and I know a lot of you all have seen him around, and a lot of you already know him, is Coach Cy Alexander. He's been identified as our Director of Donor Engagement for the Aggie Athletic Foundation, if he could stand up. Like I said, I know, of course, he was our former head basketball coach, so I know all of you know him. He definitely has been out there engaging our donors, talking to our donors, letting you all know why your donations are so important, as well as being involved in a lot of our Aggie Athletic Foundation events that we've had around while we were traveling to different athletic competitions. Additionally, I wanted to just say thank you to everybody. Thank you so much for your contributions. And I just wanted to touch a little bit. I know a lot of you all have a lot of questions about our benefit structure, and some of you all not so happy about the benefit structure, but just wanted to touch bases. We develop these marketing pieces to let you know the reason why we increase our benefit structure and how your contribution helps our student athletes. And that's the main reason why we give, right? Is to help our student athletes, is to because we have a tie to the university and we love Aggie Athletics. That's the reason why we give. And so this outlines the different prices and the different fees associated with our student athletes coming here to North Carolina A&T. Housing, transportation, scholarships in and out of state. To touch a little bit on what Katricia just showed us, how much it costs for a student out of state to come here, or how much it costs for a student that's in state to attend North Carolina A&T. And so one of our goals of the AAF, of course, is to fund all scholarships for our student athletes. And so by doing that, we definitely need to be able to contribute more to athletics, and so that's what we're doing. My door is always open. A lot of you already know that I'm located in Moore Gym. A lot of you already know my telephone number, so if you all have any questions, any concerns, please, please feel free to contact me, and I am definitely always available. And a lot of you all have my cell phone number as well. Does anybody have any questions before we close out? Because I know a lot of y'all call me. Y'all gonna call me on Monday. Please come down if you do. Please come down to the microphone if you have any questions or concerns. Did you have a question?
Well, I just want to know, can I post this on social media?
Oh, absolutely. And that's already Angelica, which is our event person and administrative assistant, posts normally a lot of our information, not normally, all the time, all of our information as regards to our benefit structure, any events that are taking place, any upcoming events, and any new information that takes place. So as we went over, we're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and now on YouTube. So all that information is located there, as well as on our website as well, aggieboosters.com. Any other questions? concerns. There is still food out here for everyone. If you all want to eat, I know everybody's getting anxious for the spring game, so we're going to head it close out. Again, thank you all so much for coming. You all have a great day.